pledge. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome. May I have a motion, please, that the agenda of February 11th, 2014 be approved as submitted?
Second.
Questions or comments? Thank you. All those in favor? 6 in favor, none opposed. Thank you. May I have a motion, please, that the consent agenda, as listed in your agenda, be approved?
So moved.
Second.
Questions or comments? Thank you. All those in favor? 6 in favor, none opposed. Thank you. Special reports. We welcome this evening from BOCES 1, Dan White, superintendent of BOCES 1, and also our representative on the BOCES board, Fred Shippey. Good evening. Welcome. Please have a seat at the table. We're going to ask that you use the microphone so that people who are at home can hear you.
Certainly. Good evening, and thank you for the invitation. See many, many familiar faces. We make an attempt to come out and visit local component boards of education at least once a year to say hello, say thank you for your partnership as we jointly educate the students of our component districts, including Penfield students. Many of you I know participated relatively recently in a visit of our programs and facilities, and we thank you for that. Just to let you know, that invitation is always there. It is, if there's something specifically that individual board members or as a board you want to see, you are always welcome. So please do not hesitate. You certainly don't need a written invitation to do that. We are made up of our component district, so we are you essentially on that. So a couple quick updates. I was joking with Dr. Grimm that I'm fresh off the throughway from a very interesting Board of Regents meeting that is mm-hmm. taking place. So I expect there's a number of different items that came out of that meeting, including some what they would call emergency regulations. We're expecting to get some clarification on exactly what those are and the impact of those things sometime later on this week, and we'll get those out to districts as soon as we possibly can. And I think it's going to involve some discussion about exactly what are the implications of some of the regulations they passed, how does it affect some of the programs and our students. But I think it's safe to say from all of us, it's been a very interesting couple of years. And maybe we should move on to a different topic on that. a couple things going on with us as an organization. You obviously, again, had visited and seen many, many of our programs. A couple things. One, we're engaged in what we call a space utilization study as a Board of Education. You may or may not know, when you came to visit, you saw our main facilities, but we really have 40 or so different locations spread out all over the east side of the county that range from storefront type of spaces for adult education that's up in East Irondequoit to buildings in East Rochester, Losey Bird Mortgage School for K-8 programming, and then the main campus that you saw at the Foreman Center. Also a technology building and a school improvement building on Linden Park. We're spread out, and we lease the vast majority of our spaces as an organization, as most BOCES do. We do own the main Foreman Center building and the Harris building, which is up bared a little bit, but the rest of our facilities we lease either from component districts or different entities around. And as those leases periodically come due, we have to make decisions about what's the fiscally responsible and the educationally responsible thing to do for our facility. So we've engaged Labella Architecture to come in and help us look at how we're utilizing our facilities, not only look at the status of those from a physical standpoint, but how it really meets our programmatic needs currently and then moving into the future, because we have to make some space decisions. Labella presented to our Board of Education last week some of the preliminary findings. We expect this will be an ongoing process for us into the spring with some harder recommendations for us as we get toward the end of the school year. And there'll be maybe some minor construction implications, but this is more about how we use our current space and how we should be using it to be more efficient rather than it's about building new space and so forth. Our intent is to really, if we can, to shrink our footprint a little bit. Space is expensive. We're trying to be the most efficient we can, but also increase really the educational factor of our space. So that's something Mr. Sansusi sits on our management steering committee as a BOCES. So that's something that they will be seeing later on in the spring as a committee and as we ask our our component district personnel to help us walk through some of this process. So I expect you'll be getting some additional information on that shortly in the spring. Secondly, you may have noticed in the paper today some information about career and technical education programs in Rochester City School District, but it's been a big discussion in the last couple of years, really workforce development and job development in our area. We're undergoing a process where we're looking at career and technical education programs from a regional perspective. So that would be BOCES 1, BOCES 2, Orleans BOCES on the west side of the city, as well as Rochester City School District, and our two other what we call joint management team BOCES in our area, Genesee Valley, as well as Wang Finger Lakes. The point being, trying not to duplicate programs per se, but really trying to make sure that we're meeting workforce needs in the area. One of the adjustments we've made as a BOCES is we've really shifted what had been a precision machining program into really an advanced manufacturing technology program that's going to provide students a better basis to go into things like optics, clean room manufacturing, and really can branch off into many different areas that are available at some of our local higher ed institutions, MCC, RIT, and so forth, a real workforce development need in our area. In addition, we run five CTE programs that are based upon medical needs, so to speak, medical careers, which, as you know, in the Rochester area is significant. So we work very closely with workforce investment boards and so forth, area employers, try to make sure our programs are really up to date as we're moving forward. And that also, as you know, plays into space needs. As you know, as a school district, you look at what programming needs you have now and into the future and how your space is configured to be able to do that. So that's a significant initiative for us. And then finally, we are concluding this year really our budgeting process. Again, the management steering has been involved in that. We have some unique things going on in our special education programs. Actually, we have, for the last number of years, we have had a relatively steady decline in the number of students that have come to us for what we call center-based or direct special education programs that are on our campus. That trend is really reversed in the last year or so. There's a number of different reasons why that is. Frankly, a number of different dynamics going on both in the state as well as the community. That's had a positive effect on some of our program budgets, of course. So we are trying to be as responsive as we can to the fiscal needs that we know our components have. Obviously, the tax cap levy is about 1.46%. We know the revenue constraints right now. You're very aware of them, as are we. We're trying to be as responsive as we can to those things, knowing that costs like pension, healthcare continues to rise and so forth. All the same issues that you struggle with or did you work with in putting together a budget, those are the same type of things that we work with folding into that as well. So we look at financial planning much like you do from a long-term perspective, with the idea that we want to ensure that we don't have a roller coaster of spike in rates for component districts, so it's easier for you to plan when you do budgeting from a long-term perspective as well. So that's really what I had on my agenda, Steve, in terms of some basic updates as to what's going on, but I would be happy to entertain any questions, comments, or at all that your board might have.
Well, first, thank you for being here this evening and for all the information you just shared with us, and I'll turn it over to board members. Any questions or comments? John?
The tour was excellent. One of the things I noticed when you talk about the trend going backwards, in some part of the building, and you have like 12 people from Hillside working, and you have doctors and nurses. So,
sure.
To me, it seemed like, you know, it was a one-stop medical center type of thing.
Sure.
Is that kind of the trend for parents that, or is that something that you've had to do?
John, it's a great question, because that's a joint program operated by Monroe and BOCES and Hillside, and there are certain things as an educational organization we can do, and there are certain things we'd have to rely on an organization like Hillside to be able to do. Those are students with very intensive needs, as you saw. But to answer your question, not only in our community but statewide, the numbers of students we're seeing who have dramatic needs that needs to be serviced has risen, frankly. We're seeing that not only in our adolescent population, but at the primary ages as well, as we have opened similar classrooms to those at Lois E. Byrd Morgan School, again, K-2. So that's a dynamic that is happening societally, and I think there's a couple reasons why. One is community services, whether they be mental health-based or whatever, not as readily accessible as they are, have been in the past. And that has a lot to do with the state budget and the services that are available to families in the past. Number two, I think we've all realized with students with very intensive needs, the more you can wrap around services, the better, so that you have the necessary social work and mental health supports available for students, as well as being, the intent is to maximize the time you can have those students in the classroom learning, because many of those students are still working on the same learning standards that all students are that are around buildings. But that's a definite trend that we're seeing. And it's not just our BOCES, but again, I hear that from my colleagues, other district superintendents around the state. Great question, though.
Thank you. Board members, other questions, comments? Barb?
Isn't there a Fairport girls basketball game right
there
now?
There is, yes. Okay. It's senior night, so I'm guessing that maybe I have probably got a half an hour that I bought a little bit of time.
Just thought I'd ask, so I'm done.
It was nice to see such a great turnout from the Penfield Board at the Monroe County School Board Association Legislative Breakfast. It's important that we make a good impression on the legislators. Y'all did a great job showing up. And from the weather forecast, weather sounds good Thursday for the election, so we'll see you there, I'm sure.
Yes, definitely.
I just want to personally thank Dan and Fred for coming here tonight. Really means a lot. And the great work that you're doing for the students of Penfield at Monroe One is just outstanding. Thank you.
We appreciate it very, very much. And I know you have a very full agenda this evening, so I will excuse myself and maybe I'll catch the tip, folks. So enjoy your evening. Thanks for the opportunity.
Thank you. Yep. Enjoy the game.
Yeah, yep. Thank you.
All right, and our student representative is not here this evening, and I do not have any indication that somebody would like to address the board. So we now move on to superintendent's reports. Dr. Grimm.
Okay, great. We've got student and staff honors. We also will have an English and social studies program presentation. We saw math, science, and technology at our last meeting, and now we're including more core academic presentations for the board to understand our core business and where we are and where we're going. The capital budget review, Dr. Sanssouci will take us through that portion of the budget. And also to talk about a veterans tax exemption, which has been kind of on the outskirts of knowing about, and we want to make sure we clarify what that means for Penfield. So our student and staff honors, we have our Science Olympiad at the high school. The team brought home over 30 individual medals at the regional competition. Team A also took third place honors and will continue on to the state competition in March. And with such outstanding performance, I want to just name the people that are in the picture there. We have Jonathan Aronov, Tezia Zhao, Patty Carpenter, Felix Wheelocker, Matt Moon, Jeff Guo, Ian Stewart, Melissa Zia, Aaron Walsh, Mirjima Purak, Tayaba Arshad, Katie Pendleberry, Lauren Sedita, Claire Wells, our own Gwenny Goldfeder, Ari James, and Melissa Tylock. And wonderful things, a science Olympiad. And I see those students are involved in so many other activities, and they're in this too. It's amazing. Our Patriot Pen Awards. Three Bay Trail students have been named winners in the VFW Post 820s Patriot Pen Contest. And thank you to the Post for offering that contest. Isabella Watty, first place, Samantha Zulgit in second place, and Alyssa Telsdetter in third place. Nice job, middle school. The Rotary Dictionary Project, we know that and have come to expect it every year here in Rotary when our local Rotary gives out dictionaries to all of our third grade students, and they also, I believe, hand them to the private schools as well. It is an effort to provide all third grade students with a dictionary of their own. It's across the nation. And this year, Rotary has reached a $1.9 million students. And Rotary has reached cumulatively overall in multiple years 21.6 million students. And our own Penfield Rotary Club has sponsored 4,560 of these dictionaries to Penfield third graders. It's exciting to distribute those and see the expression on their face, and the teachers are always very grateful. And they use it. It's not just something, here's your dictionary. They integrate it into their curriculum and use it all year long. So thank you very much, Penfield Rotary Club. And now we're to the point of our K-12 humanities programming update. And we talked about English and social studies curriculum. When we talk about them together, English and social studies together, we refer to them as the humanities. And I'll introduce Mr. Pfeiffer, our assistant superintendent for instruction, who will comment on the program.
Thank you, Dr. Grimm. It's exciting to have Jonna Wright here to talk about the progress that's being made in the area of humanities, particularly in ELA and social studies in the district. You know, it's been an interesting, I think, couple of years, and I know, to say the least, an interesting 7 or so months for Jonna and I coming into to the district at the time that we did. And there's a great deal of work to be done in the area of English language arts, and social studies is an interesting prospect right now with the potential of yet another new set of standards potentially coming our way and kind of out there in the wings. And so it's, you know, for the last 6 months, Jonna and I have been spending a great deal of time trying to analyze where the district is. And it's one of the things that makes it so interesting is Penfield has continued to be such a high-performing district. So when you're coming in from the outside and really trying to understand what efforts have been made in the past and how do we build upon those and carefully continue that success and move us into the future, there's some delicate balancing that needs to be done there. But I really know that and appreciate the hard work that Jonna and Christina Lenzo have been doing and reaching out to teachers and principals and getting out and spending time in the buildings to figure out where we are and what we've done so far to find those successes and build upon them to ensure our success in the future. So with that, John, I'll be providing you with a summary of where we are and where we plan to go.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And I just want to, before I start, thank all the department chairs, the principals, and the team leaders that collaborated all together to put together this presentation for the continued hard work that everyone does in the area of ELA and social studies. I'm proud to be leading some of those activities, those charges. Even as late as today, we had elementary teachers scoring a common assessment altogether so we could have a professional level discussion around impressions and what does that mean for our instruction. It was a very rich discussion. So to begin, of course, as Jim stated, we have tons of celebrations in the district as we look and continue to look forward in our development in the areas of ELA and social studies. These are last year's rankings in the Monroe 1 area compared to our component districts, and so they are exciting results. I remember Dr. Maloney was sending me Global Regions results in June as I was finishing up in my other position and looking forward to some of the things that I was coming into. Again, these are some discussions that we're continuing to have. The results are fantastic and we want to maintain them, and we would like to, likewise to Dr. Maloney, move up to, you know, first position in most of those areas, but also make sure that the programs that we're offering our students are rich and rigorous. In the area of elementary English language arts, again, we're in our second year, similarly to math and science, in the transition to the Common Core, and we're continuing to look at our units, our resources, and our programs district-wide, you know, K-5, K-8, and how are we aligning not only at the grade level but vertically as well, because the new standards are progressions. For the first time in English language arts, we see that they are actual progressions, similar to math, not a scope and sequence where we check off one standard and that's done and now we move into something from fourth to fifth grade. They build on each other. One thing that we did have dug in deep into, and again as late as today, and the work will continue through the rest of the week with a common assessment at the elementary level and having that discussion, is when we got our state results back, we did look deeper into the area of writing. It's some place that elementary teachers just typically aren't prepared to teach in that area of writing unless they've had some more formal training in the area of writing. So it's something that we're looking into as we continue to build that program. We really want to build strong writers for our kids so they become college and career ready. And the work of the K-5 ELA committee is ongoing. Jim mentioned social studies. We've actually brought, we're bringing the social studies committee together with the ELA committee. It was something that was done in the past, and it's very pertinent now, too, as we look at units and the progressions of how units will be built at the elementary level. Bringing some of that content area into the discussion with the reading and the writing is very important. It's actually one of the shifts in the Common Core standards for ELA. As we look at middle school English language arts, similarly, second year of transition to the Common Core, it's been fantastic. The middle school, due to the scheduling, have great department, grade level department times that they can talk about the things they're seeing in their own data and what is that continued alignment that we can actually bring back to department meetings. Right after the break, we will have a department meeting, and that's when, you know, these vertical discussions really occur. We're excited about the developments in this area. After the break, there was a common small, when I say assessment, sometimes it's really just a writing sample that's common between the grade levels or within a grade level that people want to bring back and look at all together. So that's some of the data that we're looking at on a regular basis, and where are we seeing our kids develop in some of the, what the standards are asking them. This year we did introduce some ready materials, and that helped teachers with some alignment to what do those questions look like in terms of Common Core. They're a bit more rigorous, and it gave us something to look at as a model too. In the high school English language arts area, again, lots of developments. The passing rate remains very high, and Penfield has a long legacy of fantastic achievement, and we plan to continue that. My comments around this second bullet have changed day to day this week. I was going to make mention that the freshman class right now would be that first class to take that Common Core aligned English test. But I think we're waiting for final decisions in that area, as Dan White alluded to as well. But whether that happens or not, the departments are really excited to start digging in, and they have dug in and looked at even some of the eighth grade materials because that test has already changed. So we've dug in deep as to what did those students that are now ninth graders face last year? What were the questions they looked at? And what are some of those continued materials? The first chance I had to meet with some of those ninth grade teachers, we looked at the state data, and they wanted to know, you know, where are the questions, where do we see the responses or the writing, and it's very different than the regents. The regents, they get that information back, the 3-8 programming, we don't get that back. So again, we brought some ready materials so they could see something that might be comparable in terms of those questions and what the kids might see, but I think that was a little bit surprising, you know, that the 3-8 programming really doesn't get a lot of that feedback from the state. But they've been really excited to dig in deep into those areas and look at what the students are being asked to do. And lastly, I think this is really kind of a theme in the high school and really all areas, as it's built right into the standards, is a focus on the technology resources. But the English Language Arts Department, the Social Studies Department, continue to look at things like Turnitin.com, flipped classrooms. How can they engage students through the technology that our students are so native to? In the area of elementary social studies, and as Jim alluded to as well, right prior to the December break, there were a draft of standards that went out for public comment in the area of social studies. So we're waiting to see. The public comments were taken until January 20th, and we might see some direction as early as April as to where we'll go with those standards, which again, in the true humanities feel, it's very much a marry of bringing some of that content area right into the area of ELA. So as we look forward to that guidance, we're looking at multidisciplinary units, which is called for in the standards anyway, and it really enriches students' learning anyway as they learn to read and write in all content areas. In the middle school social studies area, again, exciting developments as social studies and ELA really still continue to partner together. We're actually in April looking at, you know, combining some of the scoring, combining some of those professionals so that we can really develop the partnership and people can see across the discipline areas what's being asked in ELA, and looking at some of those departmental meeting times to bring people together as well. But in terms of developments, social studies is really looking at the ELA Common Core Standards. In the draft of the Social Studies Common Core Standards, the first 3 to 4 pages are the ELA standards. So it really calls for that partnership to continue anyway, which is already established, which is fantastic. As social studies, again, looks toward 21st century learners, we're looking at building upon some teachers that have really looked at the resources that they use and building curriculum around technology, the use of technology, but also how to file that, how to save that, and really building a technology-based curriculum rather than solely textbooks or passages. And that's really exciting to see, too. Our high school social studies, again, tons of celebrations. It's really the humanities feel across the board. Some of our AP results, and you can see they're fantastic results. Drawing attention just to the areas that look like they're a little bit lower in some areas, and that's reflective of some of the participation in some of those classes. Over time, the English literature and the government and politics, those numbers have actually decreased a little bit over time. So if you look at every single student, they count as a percentage of that total score. So as we see a few of the numbers decrease, that's reflective in that score as well. But in the AP government and politics, that's actually an upward trend, which is great. So if we looked over the past couple years, we are looking at a 62%, a 52%, and then an upswing to 68%. So it's a really good upswing. I'm getting a little different feedback around that. And then the English literature, again, the numbers have decreased, but the number of students earning a 3 or better has really remained the same. So that's great. And continued development. As we look at 21st century learners, the demands of where we want our kids to be, what can be offered in the area of humanities. Very excited about offering the SUPA class in economics. Again, continuing over the past few years to add the 9 through 11 paired classes, so a social studies English class co-taught in that true spirit of humanities, which is awesome. Looking at a SUPA sociology class, which Tim Graves is excited about, and that would be actually potentially part of the Futures Project, which is just a whole other area of excitement. And again, looking at some of that continued technological infiltration into the classrooms, flipped classrooms, and how to get kids really engaged and then really doing the work once they're in class. Any questions?
Thank you. That was a lot of information very quickly, but thank you. We appreciate that. Board members, questions or comments? John.
Go back to the slide. The AP government and politics.
Yes.
You know, like this is kind of just surprising, 68%.
Yeah.
We need to bring some of our assemblymen into the class and get their attention up, or maybe that wouldn't be a good thing, but.
And again, it is a reflection of some of the decreased, a few decreased numbers just recently in time in terms of participation in that class. Liz Smith and I really talked about this too with Frank Byrassi about also continuing to focus on keeping seniors on the wave of up, on the way out. A lot of times what happens too in a couple of these areas is that they register for the AP now, they get accepted to college, and some of them may or may not even sit for the exam. So also keeping that in mind and keeping them up on that upward spiral. And the courses are rigorous, and the participation is there, but really continuing to boost them in those areas.
And some specific numbers on that, John. Last year, 91 students took that exam and 47 passed. 2 years ago, I'm sorry. Last year, only 69 students took it and 47 passed. So, you know, it's just, and the same, similarly with the AP Lit, we had 48 students 2 years ago and 43 passed. In 2012, only 28 students took it and 23 passed. So, and as Jonna mentioned, then when those numbers go down like that, each student accounts for such a large percentage each time that it's tough. It really hits those numbers very heavily.
I would also add that when you're looking at the AP exams, one of the things we want to make sure we try to do is make sure that there's an opportunity for people to be able to get into those courses. So we have to be careful about the gatekeeping. You know, do you have to have a certain percentage to be able to try the course? So we want to grow the numbers. It's good to see more students are taking the AP exams. And sometimes when you grow the numbers, sometimes the percentage is fluctuating too, depending on how many people are taking it. And what we want to do is grow the number of students in it and grow the passing rate. So both of those kind of go together. It's not one or the other.
And what we're going to continue to look at, again, with some of the standards changes and development, the APs are also developing and changing too. The College Board site right now is very reflective of Common Core learning standards. So I think that the Common Core learning standards are infiltrating into what the College Board is developing. Liz Smith went to something earlier in the year and came back with some of the developments that we will see through the AP exams and said, wow, if this is what Common Core looks like, you know, we need to continue to prep in that area. So as those discussions are already going on with social studies around the ELA and the Common Core, we'll be ready for those developments.
Mark, you had a question?
I was just going to ask the question that I think Dr. Grimm addressed, which is how the students and the faculty determine who should be enrolled in these AP courses, and how does that affect the outcome of the grades? Because we want to have more people enrolling these courses, but we also want to have success.
I think it is teacher recommendation. I am going to, Terry Febre is here in the audience, so I will ask her to.
Teacher recommendations, we removed all the gates. We do talk with them, and we feel if it's an appropriate choice or not. So we try to give them some guidance before they go ahead and take it.
But I know that all the teachers really encourage the participation if the students and families feel as though that they would like them to participate in that rigor in that class.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think that teachers do a nice job with that recommendation process, being really thoughtful about that.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions or comments?
Yes, can I ask you, do we know the AP exams, is there some hardship in paying the fee to take that exam? Do we know if this is what's keeping some students from taking the exam sometimes?
That I am not aware of at this point, but I can certainly look into that.
Okay, because it is a hefty fee, especially if you're taking several AP exams. And I know we get, you know, the savings later when the kids go to college, if they've had a good score, but still, when you have to pay all of this, you know, in high school.
Absolutely.
A couple of years ago, we introduced pre-AP. How did that do? Did that decrease at all our numbers in the paired class? Or not? How did that do?
No, we still have some of that programming going on. The paired classes are alive and full and in full force. So I don't know that there's really any competition between the two. There are great numbers. Tom and I were just talking about that this afternoon. There are great numbers that participate in the honors. But then again, without the gatekeeping of sorts for the AP, you get students participating likewise in both. And that's where we see the great Regents returns as well, because some of those honor students are staying in those paired courses and then moving on to AP as well.
Okay. And since this is a class that we introduced a couple of years ago, do we sit down and reevaluate it? Was that a good idea or not a good idea or something like that?
The paired courses?
Not the paired. The paired, I have been here forever, but it's the pre-AP one, you know, that the freshmen take, I think.
Yes. Yes, and actually, yeah. We're looking at some of those right now, too, waiting for some of the guidance to come, both from the College Board in terms of what those developments will be and the change in standards there, but also with the social studies guidance and those standards changing as well. We're in kind of deep discussions with English language arts and social studies around programming and what does that look like.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
I would just add that, you know, we have John, and thanks for being here. Thanks for doing such great work in the short time you've been here. I also have Lisa Henry, who's our department chair at the high school level, and Liz Smith, that I know through working with them and seeing what they're doing, and the professional development days, just outstanding work as we prepare for the Common Core layout in the high school. And as you see, the 2016 is when our freshmen are going to be taking that course, and the freshman teachers are actively working together, and Liz and Lisa have them working hard at that level. And similarly, I observed Winton Buddington on our staff development day facilitating along with Assistant Principal John Burke with about 60 teachers to talk about what text-dependent questions means for their area. And it wasn't just the ELA and the social studies, it was all of the teachers, and how that is a part of all of their lives and how it needs to be part of their vocabulary and integrated in their teaching styles. It's very interesting and enlightening. And what we found is sometimes text-dependent questions, you think, okay, here's the question, right, what year was he born? And you go back and you find the answer, oh, he was born on this year. You know, that's a very simple type of activity. But the questions now are, why would he have gone to Washington when he did that? And it's not like right there, but you have to really understand what's going on. And to see our middle-level principal and an assistant principal leading that type of instruction, rich instructional dialogue on something so current and important was exciting to see. And that the teachers had a good time with it, and they walked away with some meaningful, tangible evidence. And then at elementary level, is they're sorting all of those things out. It's just outstanding to see the work that the practitioners are doing at the classroom level and that teacher leadership level. Very proud of that. Couldn't happen without all that hard work. So commend to all of them.
Okay, well, thank you for coming this evening. We really appreciate this presentation, part of our program review. Thank you.
Okay, and now we've got Dr. Sanssouci, who's going to take us through the next portion of our budget, which also, which he always does a nice job of, kind of like some of those weekly programs where you get a little bit of a review in the first couple of minutes. Where have we been? Where are we going? This is what you missed in the last episode. Keeps you caught up, even if you missed our last episode. And the other thing we have online, Nancy Bradstreet, our Director of Communications, has done a wonderful job of taking the budget items and putting them all in one spot on the website. You can see just the video portions of the budget presentations, so you don't have to be searching around on the web, and we try to put all those things in one spot. So with that, Dr. Sanssouci.
Thank you. I'd like to go through, as Dr. Grimm mentioned, the presentation tonight on capital, which is the buildings and grounds, the transportation, and the debt service portions of our budget. So really the items that impact the infrastructure that allows instruction to go forward. Also want to review a little bit with the public where we're at with regard to our tax cap discussions. I'm sorry. We had a board workshop this most recent Saturday on the 8th, and had some discussion around that. Want to bring everyone up to speed with regard to that. And of course, close a little bit with the veterans exemption. I've invited tonight two of the folks that are integrally involved with this budget. So tonight in the audience are Alan McNiff, whom you all have met most of you, I think, have met very recently on the board tours of the buildings, and also Gina Chopa. I'm going to ask Alan and Gina to come to the table if they could. I'll go through the presentation, but there are some changes particular to the way we're structuring the buildings and grounds budget. Alan is brand new to the position, as you know, and with a fresh look comes change, so we want to sort of make sure you understand what's going on in that regard. And I know later on the agenda in a separate spot, certainly if there are no budget questions, there's no significant change to the transportation portion, but I do know you have quite a few policies on the agenda with regard to transportation as well, so I thought we'd get everything buttoned down at one time. So with that, we always begin our presentations around board goals. Just to remind everyone that the purpose for which we're here, which is, of course, that students can learn and learn in a safe and safe environment. And tonight, you know, these pieces of the budget fit into that goal around a safe environment, around an environment that's warm, around an environment that's healthy, and on a safe trip to and from school. That consumes 14% of our budget. So buildings and grounds, transportation, debt service, are 14 of the 100%. Later in the year, we'll be looking at our next meeting in March, we'll be looking at the regular instructional program. That's the majority, the single largest piece of our budget. We're in the process of working on BOCES right now. We'll present that second meeting in March, benefits in April, and we need to adopt a budget by April 22nd. So tonight, again, this is the budget pie. You can see the transportation, debt service, and buildings and grounds, while significant at 14% of the budget, is smaller in total than the instructional portions. And tonight, that entire budget is up 0.9%. So that covers maintenance of the buildings, upkeep of the grounds, the fields that surround our buildings, student transportation, purchase or replacement buses, and debt service, which is really the mortgage payments on the district's facilities. This is the way that looks like in a graphical format. So overall, there's a 0.9% increase. You can see transportation is fairly flat. Buildings and grounds has a bit of an increase. Debt service flat. And in the middle, you see replacement of buses going up. The red bar, remember, is the 14-15 budget, so, and the blue bar 13-14 this year. So in the budget this year, there were a maintenance project, the finalized funding of the project at Bay Trail and Scribner for replacement of the electrical equipment at Bay Trail and the construction of the new entrance. There was $150,000 worth of additional funding in this year's budget for that project. That's going away next year. But coming into the budget, getting built in now, is $85,000 for this year towards the replacement of buses. The majority of our buses will still be purchased out of the bus purchase reserve. You'll recall that this year 100% of all our buses, 6 buses, were replaced. None of that money in the general fund, all of that coming out of reserve. Next year, $85,000 will go into the general fund budget, an additional $85,000 the year after, and we build back in over the course of the next 10 years the capacity for the general fund to support that purchase. So this is the first step of that long-range plan. Also tonight, I mentioned some of the changes, more significant changes, in that buildings and grounds budget. You'll recall in the graph you just saw that was one of the areas that was increasing. It's increasing in a couple of ways. It's increasing in repair of equipment and repair of buildings. There's also a modest decrease of $2,000 of a budget line that's really sort of outlived its usefulness. But I would, I'd like to ask Mr. McNiff to go through those changes since really he was integral to the development of them and they really impact his portion. So,
great.
Alan, I'm going to turn it over to you.
All right, thanks, Mark, and I appreciate being here tonight to have a chance to explain to you how I've seen things as I've kind of been here for the last 6 months or so. The first thing that I did when I first was brought on board was look at the budget.
to understand where what we had and how it's allocated, and I wanted to track it closely. So I've kind of changed the way that we've been managing the money in our office so that we're tracking it on a daily basis to see how our percentages of usage is going throughout the year. And through the last 6 months, it was apparent to me that two of the categories, repair of buildings and repair of equipment, really on the line of our expenditures throughout the course of the year. I've been very careful on what we spend our money on as far as repairs to the buildings. When I mean that we're right on the line, I am very careful about selecting what items we put our repairs as far as priority is concerned. There are some repairs that I would like to do, but I necessarily can't do at this point. We have to be very selective on what we do and how we go about doing that. So that's why you'll see that I have requested some increase for those categories because of those, because I'm starting to project into what next year those expenditures could be. One thing, though, to briefly point out, as Mark had mentioned, the repair of vandalism. We have a cost code that has been in the budget for many of years. That's basically a value around $2,000. And quite honestly, I'm suggesting that we delete that from our budget code and basically place that money into the repair of buildings code. Essentially, the same vendors are in that code. Unless we're going to track that specifically for vandalism, we could always pull that out and show that to you if you needed that. But we really don't have that much vandalism, just a separate point. So I'm suggesting to remove that. As far as repair of equipment, you'll see that requesting an increase there of around 13%. You can see what our current budget value is. And kind of the majority of reason why my request is, and you'll see these are consistent between repair of buildings and repair of equipment, is the increase in repair work expected with equipment age. The buildings are still moving, they're still getting older. Even though we've done some large capital project, there's sections of other buildings that have not been touched and will need to be touched at some point. And even with the capital project that we recently did, that equipment is starting to age and it always requires maintenance. So we're seeing, obviously I expect to see that. Commodities in general, obviously a lot of you probably already know that copper is always increasing. A lot of our components in our mechanical equipment is made out of copper, it's made out of steel. Those things are always increasing in cost. And I don't expect it to go down. Being from the construction world, I expect every year that to increase significantly. And then finally, labor costs from vendors. A lot of our vendors that come and do some work that is beyond our capabilities, like our Day System Automations and Siemens, those folks that are critical for our building control systems, their labor costs increase obviously every year. So again, one of those reasons why I'm looking for that increase for that category. For the repair of buildings, similar nature. This increase is a little bit higher, and I'll explain here in a moment, but as you can see that I have listed here up on the PowerPoint, you're seeing the same things are prevail here. Commodity price increase, increase in repair to the building. The envelope is still being weathered every year. Those are the type of things that that we need to address, and I'd like to include some additional capital to improve upon them. Also, is listed towards the bottom is obviously that transfer from the 2000 from the repair of vandalism. But finally, the last thing that Mark and I have talked about is including a value of around $25,000 for building enhancements. Traditionally here in the past, towards the end of the year, we have some funds that are available to do some infrastructure improvements. And what has been done is that work takes place during the summer months. I've been asking Mark to see if there's a possibility to have some of that funding provided to the budget during the school year so that potentially I could do those improvements throughout the course of the year. First of all, potentially we could do it with our own staff, so it saves on labor costs from vendors, but also it balances the work a little bit. We can do some stuff during breaks if it's from a vendor, that type of thing. Things that we can benefit throughout the year rather than just waiting for the summer and trying to put it all together at one time. So that's generally what I'm looking for is kind of the major aspects of the budget. If as you look at the other budget codes, I've asked some moderate increases just based upon inflation. You have any questions?
Thank you. Love the details of the requests. That is really nice. Board members, any questions or comments? Mark.
When you're talking about the 25,000 for building enhancements, mm-hmm. doing it over the course of the year versus at the end of the year, how much is normally spent at the end of the year? You know, how much we roll in for those enhancements over the summertime?
It's varied from year to year. I'll answer since Alan doesn't have the history, and I do, but it's varied from year to year, and it depends on the type and nature of the work. But there have been years where several hundred thousand dollars worth of work was done over the course of a year. For example, last year, I don't remember the dollar figure offhand, but we did paving replacement, paving at Harris Hill through the town, and that was significantly expensive. So those kinds of larger projects need to be done at year, have needed to be done over the course of the summer and at year end. But what Alan's proposing is that we recognize some of that in his annual budget and be able to accommodate it during the course of the year.
So that would that reduce then what we
should reduce what we do at year end? Correct.
And
exactly.
It would be more cost effective.
Be more cost effective. Be a little more planful.
Sure, thank you.
And the other part of that is as we move forward and budgets become more and more and more constrained, our capability to do that at year end is going to vanish, I think. So as we've had that conversation, we want to begin planning around that and begin building that reality in as well.
Any other questions or comments? John.
During one of the tours, I can't remember where we were, but you know, we saw some boilers, obviously. but there was a real old one.
Yes.
Okay, and we're not able to, you know, like a bus, aren't we able to have like a reserve for boilers? Or is that not?
We do. It's a capital reserve.
Right.
That's exactly
so
what it's there for.
What's the cost of one of those if it goes? I mean,
well,
a new one, I guess. What would be the replacement value?
Well, to specifically talk about, you're talking about Bay Trail, where we had old Cleaver Brooks boilers in that space, and I showed you the comparison between a new and an old, and obviously the efficiency is apparent looking at those pieces of equipment. Without knowing the knowledge of those Cleaver Brooks to see if they have any asbestos linings or things of that nature, but you could be in the neighborhood of around $150,000 per boiler, generally speaking. You have to consider the controls that are associated with that, a demo. The new equipment itself, the electrical, the gas supply, all of those items to that piece of equipment. It could range from around 150 to 200 grand, somewhere in that ballpark, conceptually speaking, just for the construction cost. Obviously, if we put it into a capital project, it has other costs associated for testing, things of that nature, and obviously architect and CM fees, of course. So give you a general idea of what to expect.
Okay. Well, but in our five-year plan, we don't have any view of replacing that in particular?
We just completed our five-year plan, so and we're on the verge of the new five-year plan. So that's one of the things that you know, the board has requested, and we've received membership on the capital project committee, or capital committee, the exact title is escaping me. But one of the tasks of that committee will be to go through, look at the building condition survey, which would include those boilers, prioritize it. One of the things that Alan and I have been having conversation about is, you know, one of the hardest things about prioritization around that building condition survey, because you may remember the last one, it's $77 million worth of stuff. And the question is, how do you pick and how do you organize around what you do? How are you going to choose? I mean, certainly if things are in crisis, that has to be a priority. If things are a health and safety issue, that has to be a priority. But then when you get into the $77 million worth of needs, the architect will rank them 1 through 5, but you'll have more ones or fives than you can deal with necessarily in a year. So in the past, and those of you who were on the committee last time will remember, we struggled with, should we do it by building? Should we organize by building? How should we put this together? And I think that our preliminary conversations have to do with energy efficiency, that we really are interested in organizing and looking through, and that one of the filters we'd like to talk about applying as the committee talks about that is that of energy efficiency. So that means lots of things, but it can mean windows. I know that, for example, you know, anecdotally, we know that windows at emergency windows at Harris Hill haven't been replaced in quite some time. Boilers, you saw the boiler at the high school, or at Bay Trail. Boilers at the high school are in older shape. So, and again, there's energy efficiencies to be had there. So, you know, that committee's job will be to go through that in detail, to think about those kind of filters and priorities, and begin to put some priority around that. Does that help?
Yeah, it does. And I just had one other question. I know last fall we saw a consultant's report on transportation, and is some of that resulting in this, or remember the report from the consultant?
That is very much on the table with regard to that facilities committee.
It's nothing in this budget here. This,
correct.
It hasn't gone anywhere, I guess.
It has not gone anywhere.
Okay. So it doesn't impact this.
But of our last five-year plan, work on the bus garage, which needs to be attended to, very much needs to be attended to, is the one piece we didn't knock off as we rolled through. So that'll move to probably to at least number one or number two position in the next go around, and then it's the remainder of the work. What do we see going forward in consultation with the architect, with Alan, with the other folks involved? What makes sense in terms of long-range planning to, you know, protect the building, make sure we're as efficient, as cost efficient as we can be, and that our buildings are maintained in a way that the people expect them to be.
Thanks.
We're anxious to get that, at least I am anxious to get that going, because it's time consuming, and it's a process that needs to be walked through. So let me keep going for just a little bit. I mentioned this in terms of transportation and multi-year planning. This is the $80,000 of bus purchase built into the budget. If we split it up in a little bit different way, this is by this entire budget really by the items or by the the objects that are being purchased. So salaries, you can see again, are the majority bus drivers, cleaners, custodians, and so forth, are paid for through this budget, and that's virtually unchanged. Equipment up just a little bit, utilities flat in the budget, contractual items up, again, Alan's had that explanation, materials and supplies, and payment on debt also essentially flat. Again, the little blue bar under maintenance project, that's going away, it would be red for 14-15. Overall, a $107,000 increase on a $12 million budget, so it's 0.9%. I think we jumped ahead on questions, but if there are any
others. Well, just to go back to that slide about, keep going. That one. Alan, I don't think that any of these administrators talked to you about last fall at the convention about gardens on the roof.
Oh, boy.
And
what a fine idea.
I just want to see why that's not in there. But it was pretty positive.
I'm kind of psyched about it.
These dish... Like they're like big dish tray gardens, right?
I'm not going to.
We'll talk. Okay, you do.
I know what you're
all right.
To.
Well, we'll talk later. But I'm just wondering if that would help offset some of these costs.
I think that's what those stairs at the high school were for.
Yes, exactly.
Down the stairs.
I'm not going to be part of this. Oh, but what I do want to say is we've spent an awful lot of time with you last week and asked you questions that I don't think we were going to ask, Alan. And you've showed us places in this in these buildings that we've never seen before. I'm sure the students would love to see them. You know, so, but thank you so much. And thank you for the upkeep of everything you are doing in our buildings with your team, because they look really great, even though the boilers, you know, really need to be replaced. And, you know, we're still
working on other issues, and you know, but thank you for everything you're doing. And I know we're going to be seeing you some more with more tours this week, you know.
Exactly.
So two more schools that we have to see, but I wanted to make sure before you leave to thank you for everything you've been doing.
Appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. The rest of the budget presentation has to do with the tax cap, sort of budget progress to date. I'd like to let these folks go. But before I do that, I just know that there were specifically, and I apologize for skipping ahead in the agenda, but I know that there was some, that there were policies for review around transportation. And if you had any specific questions ahead of time that you thought I might not be able to answer, now would be a good time. But other than that, I'm happy to take a crack at it, and I would let Gina go home.
Okay, so board members, there is a bunch of policies, but they're all here for first reading. So do you have any specific questions you'd like to ask now? No? We're good? Okay.
I do appreciate it. Thank you both very much.
I do want to mention one thing. Recently, and Gina Chapa there, at Transportation, I received an email from a neighboring district commenting on how wonderful the Transportation Department was when they had a time where one of their buses broke down, and we immediately jumped in, not only technically, but also how they were retreated. They just thought we had a wonderful transportation department. And I've been observing the buses as they're coming through, and neighborhoods, and what they're doing, just an outstanding job. It's almost seamless that you forget about how difficult it is to make that organization run the way it does. And the buses that are in such great shape, we just take it for granted because it's always perfect. It's always there. It's always great. It's always on time. And with the weather that we've had, it's such a difficult to operate and maneuver and change schedules, and the quality of our driving that's happening, and the buses that are in shape, and the buildings and grounds are out there shoveling and plowing and salting. It's just over and over, and we're so concentrated on, well, it's another cold day. But it's another cold day that we're just, you know, in overload in terms of what our people are doing for us and that infrastructure that makes it happen every day. And just two of the most important people in our district that represent two of the most important groups of people in this district that I think sometimes we take for granted. And I'm just saying tonight, great job, and thank you to everybody.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
On that, I also, in the same vein, heard that you had a contingency plan in place if there was a snow day during Regents exams or something, and you were ready to go, and you were going to get those kids there, and that's just commendable, and I wanted to point that out as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. If you can take our appreciation to both of your groups for all that you do, we really would appreciate it.
Thank you, Carol.
Will do. Thank you.
Okay, with that, I'd like to just bring the board up to date a little bit on where we're at with regard to progress. So these are the budget presentations to date. Again, 14, 15's in red. So we've had presentations on three of the six components of the budget. If we look forward, just in based on a rollover budget, this is where we anticipate ending the year at just under 2%. There's a lot of just under 3%, 2.9%. There's a lot of work left to be done in those budgets, and it's ongoing. Particularly, I believe I mentioned to the board at the workshop that the BOCES budget needs quite a bit of attention as we're moving through. We're working on that now. So, however, it's important that we start to look forward towards the end. As you saw earlier in the presentation, we're halfway through our budget presentations. That vote in May comes up awfully quickly. So we want to start looking forward as we look at the components, sort of lift our eyes a little bit and see where we're going. And an important part of that is the tax cap. So come March 1st, we're obligated to submit our data on the tax cap to the state. So really the month of February is when we need to figure that out, and that's in process. We're doing it right now. So the factors that go into that cap are, I apologize, that says allowable levy growth. That's actually the amount of growth in assessed valuations in the community. So it's the amount of growth in our community that's caused by new bricks and mortar, not reassessment, not changes in the value of assessment, not changes in equalization rate, but the real amount of new growth in the community. So the first year of the cap, that was 1%. This year, for this year's budget, it was six tenths, and it was 6/10, and it will be going forward this the exact same amount. So fairly steady there, but somewhat significant growth in the community. The tax base growth factor and the rate of inflation are related. So the tax base growth factor is that the 2%, that's the number in the 2% tax cap that we know by now, and I think our public's beginning to realize, we're all starting to understand that it will almost never, the math of that complicated calculation will almost never work out to be 2%, but there is 2% used in the formula. And that 2% is that the tax base is allowed to grow by the lesser of the rate of inflation or 2%, always the lesser of. So in 12-13, when inflation was at 3.2%, the tax cap was at 2. For this year's budget, 13-14, when the calculation was done, the rate of inflation was 2.1, and the calculation used 2%. This year, as we move forward, the rate of inflation will be 1.46%, so that's what will get used in the calculation, 1.46%. So how does that, and that will work its way into the calculation I'll show you in just a minute. To look back, our levy increase for a six-year average is 1.77%. So last year was more significant than it had been in five of the previous years. But when you average that out over time, we've been living prior to the adoption of this new tax levy limit within the boundaries of what it would have allowed. This is what those variables look like for this year's calculation. So you start with the prior year's levy, that's this year's, of $57,000,004. You're allowed to increase that by the amount of the tax base growth factor, that's the 0.6%. That along with your pilot agreements equals an adjusted levy that then is allowed to go up by 2% or less, in this case less, 1.46%, and then finally, it's adjusted again for the coming year's pilots, which are decreasing for us. And that's important because the interrelationship here between pilots, which are payments in lieu of taxes, and the tax levy are that the formula intends to freeze you to a total dollar amount. If pilots go up, if your anticipated pilots go up, if a new business comes into the community, applies to the County of Monroe Industrial Development Board, is granted a pilot, and that money then comes to the district in the form of a payment in lieu of tax, they're not on the roll because they've gotten that deal, then the levy limit, the amount of money you're allowed to collect in taxes, goes down. So if the pilots go up, the levy goes down. If the pilots go down, the levy goes up. It's intended to neutralize the impact of those pilot payments so that you always are on the same base. So if I include that estimated pilot decrease for next year, the cap for us is 2.4%. What I'm anticipating is that the cap will be 2 to 2.4%. There's one pilot property that is scheduled to come off of the rolls. It should come off of the rolls. If it does, we'll be at 2.4%. If it does not, and sometimes they do not come off on schedule. If it doesn't come off on schedule, we'll get the pilot money, and as a result of that, we will get less levy, allowable levy, we'd be at 2%. So again, the total amount of revenue to the district in this calculation, this part of the calculation, remains the same, but we need to finalize this by March 1st. So I'm working on that right now. Right now, we're planning around 2.4% because we expect and we understand that pilot payment is due to expire, so we'll see how that works. Where does that put us? Right in almost the perfect average. There's a few districts I don't have information for yet, but you can see the remaining districts in the county, their tax levy cap at 2.4%, we're almost perfectly the average. But they range from just over 3.6% to 1.7 or so percent, depending on the district. The tax levy cap is important to the district because it controls a significant amount of our revenue. So 66% of the district's revenue comes from the real property tax, 25% comes from state aid, and 9% comes from all other sources. So the levy limit controls that 66% of our revenue. And why that matters is this. 2.4% of our levy, this year's levy, is $57 million. So that returns the amount of that allowable increase then is $1.3 million. Our budget is $87 million. And I just showed you that that's increasing by the rate of about 2.9%. $1.3 million that's fixed in our budget is 1.58%. So that difference, the difference between what 66% of our budget can grow at 2.4, and the rate of increase on the expenditure side is that gap. I included a few other districts here because this isn't a unique to Penfield problem. This is a challenge that all districts across the state are going to confront, particularly in years like this where 1.4% in the calculation it reduces the amount or the possibility of what's available. So the budget increase at 2.9% is about $2.5 million. The tax cap yield, that what that calculation that we just looked at returns, is $1.3 million. So that's a gap of $1.1 million. However, there's other, remember the 9% and the 25% pieces of the pie, we're losing net a few other pieces of revenue, $457,000, for a total gap of $1.6 million. That $457,000 looks like this. We unwound a health insurance accrual last year, so that money is no longer available to be included here. We included $256,000 of federal stimulus money. That's done and gone away. Pilot payments we just talked about are going down. That $157,000 is getting picked up in the levy, but at 2.4, it's still a loss here. And state aid increases at around $417,000. Nets out to that $457,000. So all of that brings us to a gap really of around $1.6 million that'll have to be dealt with. We're in the process right now of working our way through that. So at a board, we got some board guidance at the February 8th work session. We're working our way through what that is going to entail. But certainly what we know at this point is that the revenue side of our budget, this takes getting used to for all of us, but the new learning really under the tax cap is that the revenue side of your budget, which was once under your control, is no longer. That's become fixed. So the levers that you have to pull now are on the expense side of your budget. So and also on the reserve side of your budget. So we have undone the reserve that and reach the end of that retirement accrual, so that's no longer available. Do we delve a little deeper into reserves around the retirement system reserve, which is where the remainder of those funds went, to make up that difference? What does that mean over the long term? Do we look at efficiencies throughout the district and buildings? Do we work to reduce budget lines and tighten it up? What does that mean for year-end fund balance? So those conversations are ongoing now, will continue to ongo. We're going to work our way through that process, and we'll be updating the board and the public as we move along. The next meeting of the board for a board work session is scheduled for March 15th. And as you know from the calendar, it marches on. So we'll have to finalize the tax gap calculation by March 1st. We need to finish our cost analysis. State aid is a big variable for this year. One thing that I included was the estimated state aid at $417,000 of what we know today. We know from what you've reported to us from the legislative breakfast that the legislators believe that there's going to be additional state aid available. How much will that be? What does that look like? When will we know what that is? We'll have to see. I saw today my first whiff of discussion around this not being an on-time year for a state budget, which will be interesting. But based on the fact that the Senate, I think, may end up arguing about pre-K and taxes. So there's a difference of opinion around how pre-K dollars should be allocated and raised and whether taxes on the wealthiest New Yorkers should be raised to do that. Different parties have different opinions. That's very much a budget question. So that'll need to be worked through in terms of the overall state budget that'll then inform our budget. We'll pay close attention to that because we'll want to use whatever additional funds become available. We're continuing enrollment programs, staffing reviews. We're gathering assessment data. Here again are those deadlines. Number of board meetings. We have a March 11th conversation on education schedule that's coming up fast, and the committee's meeting to plan that conversation. There's a survey available right now on our website, and we're sending notices to folks electronically that's available. So we're gathering that kind of information, meetings through March, April, and then of course finally the budget hearing in May. That budget hearing on May 6th is the last formal presentation. And then of course I always remind people that May 20th, we encourage everyone to come and vote. And we would also encourage everyone, Mr. Shippey was kind enough to give us a weather report. The weather is expected to be fine on February 13th, just 2 days from now. But we have our capital project vote here at the high school in A1 and would encourage everyone to come out at that time. Are there any questions?
Catherine.
If the state budget is not on time, do we still proceed with the numbers?
We are obligated.
Okay.
We are obligated.
Okay, thank you.
And, you know, budgets passed on time are a relatively recent phenomenon.
Yeah.
So hopefully, you know, certainly there's a lot at stake in terms of the credibility of our state government, in terms of their bond rating, in fact. You know, Moody's has opined on favorably on the on-time budgets in the course of the last couple of years. I would be very surprised if they didn't pass on time, but this year the challenges are a little bigger, I think, and there's a lot of noise in the system. So just that'll have to be quickly worked through.
Okay. All right, thank you.
Mark.
Well, you mentioned your estimated increase in state aid was around $500,000. What is that as a percentage of, what's the percentage increase that would represent?
I think we were scheduled for about a 3% increase, if I recall correctly. On what we saw in the paper. We'll actually receive a bit less than that because some of their estimates are based on estimated data for expenditure categories we wouldn't necessarily expect to receive quite as much. So I've adjusted it down a little bit, but it's 2 point some. I apologize, I don't know off the top of my head exactly.
Any other questions or comments? Okay, Mark, I know that we ended the workshop being really crunched on time, and you and I, with Dr. Grimm, we've been talking about having an additional workshop, before March 15th, because we really need to have our discussion time and you know, digest all the information that you've shared with us last weekend. So dates we're looking at, first one, Dr. Grimm is suggesting Monday, February 24th, And that would be right after budget advisory
Communication Committee or Committee, is that what it is?
Yep, Budget Advisory Committee.
Budget Advisory Committee. So that would be Monday, February 24th. The second day that we're looking at would be Tuesday, February 25th. Unfortunately, Dr. Grimm will not be in town that day.
I may not be in town on the 24th because we are scheduled to come back that day, and of course, weather permitting, we will. But I can't guarantee it.
I'm not here on the 24th.
Okay. Saturday, March 1st, which is kind of the midpoint in between the 15th. In terms of discussions or ideas that come out of that that would affect internal stakeholders, we're not set to gather with our at least extended senior cabinet before, I think it's the second week of March.
Right. I think that as Dr. Grimm and I talked about it today, the challenge, of course, is we've got that February break right smack in the middle of February, and it makes it difficult to schedule. I do think that there's some. I do feel that we did run out of time at that last meeting and just weren't able to kind of wrestle to the ground necessarily all of the conversations that should happen. If there is interest, I guess what I'd suggest is that we try a poll to perhaps see when people are available and what might be possible.
Is there interest to have an additional workshop?
Absolutely.
I'm seeing all heads nodding here.
March
1st in the morning. Okay, I haven't checked my calendar. I'm going to just nod yes for now and hope for the best. March 1st then.
All right.
Okay.
That's
March 1st then.
Okay.
Yes, please. Okay, thank you everyone for, freeing up your time for this.
Next on the agenda is just a brief reminder that the board will need to begin considering the alternative veterans exemption. As you know, this was signed by the governor. We reported on this at the last board meeting, but in late December. So we're still really learning about this and gathering information, but essentially what it allows for is a partial property tax exemption for certain qualifying veterans. In the past, towns, cities, counties could provide this. That opportunity has now been extended to schools, but it has consequences, as most things do. So the way it works is that for an eligible veteran, they are eligible based on service during a period of war, which are defined in the legislation. And they can receive exemptions based on if their war service was during in a combat zone or a non-combat zone, and also whether there's a service-related disability. And there's separate limits. It's fairly complicated, but there are separate limits and percentages for each of those categories, as well as a separate calculation for the service related disability. It's all based on percentages of assessed valuation and of the value of the home and on service. It's not means tested. So the exemptions that we're more familiar with, like the senior STAR exemption, or the district extends an exemption for senior citizens of limited income, those are means tested. This is based on solely on service. And what it does, as all these exemptions do, is it lowers the tax bill for the qualifying individuals, but it's neutral to the school district in terms of total amount of revenue. So what it does, if it lowers the tax bill for the qualifying individuals, it raises the bills of other non-qualifying folks. So it's a shift, a tax shift from one group to another. based on qualification for the program. We're working on estimating the magnitude of that impact. It's a relatively, at the highest levels, it's a relatively high exemption, and certainly the shift is higher as a result of that. There's a variety of options that the board can undertake in its consideration, and we need to gather enough data to be able to calculate those impacts at each possible level so that you can make an informed decision. The school boards has made some, New York State School Boards has made some recommendations around this. They recommend that the board understand the exemption and the exemption options, estimate and confirm those impacts. So we are continuing to work on that. But more important than the estimate, is the communication that we need to communicate with our public. School board suggests either a separate or certainly that it be included in a newsletter, because this is truly a decision that impacts the entire community. Need to schedule, there is a required public hearing. There's a requirement that there be a public hearing. So we need to, the idea would be that you need to communicate with your public sufficiently so that they, as a public, understand what the issues are, understand the potential impacts, have the public hearing to hear from folks who are concerned or opposed or in favor before taking action. And then school board's also suggesting either some sort of straw or exit poll or a survey in order to gather more data upon which to make a decision. In terms of deadlines, you can consider the exemption at any time. The first and most upon us deadline is March 1st, which is taxable status date for this next coming school year. It would be impossible, frankly, for the board to have any kind of meaningful dialogue with the public and make an informed decision by March 1st. So the signing of the bill on December and the subsequent rollout of that pretty much guaranteed that, that would be very, very difficult, if not impossible. So I think what I would recommend, what we are recommending, is that we work on developing a schedule for implementation, that we consider how we want to have that conversation with the public, that we build it into our calendar for next year. We're in the heart of budget season right now, and this doesn't really, in terms of deadlines, would be your first next opportunity would be March 1st for the next, for the 15 roll. So really, I would think that a September through November implementation, kind of the same, I modeled this really around the same kind of time frame that we used for conversations around capital projects, makes sense. That gives time in the early part of the year when our attention isn't distracted. If you try and have the conversation in the summer, people aren't always as available and aren't quite paying attention to school issues. So really it feels like an early fall kind of discussion. But certainly that's flexible. I think my best current thinking at this point. Were there any questions about the veterans exemption?
Thank you, Mark. Board members, questions or comments?
I should say the alternative would be to attempt to schedule something for this year, and I don't quite see how that's feasible. So,
can you go back to the previous slide, please? So we talk about this straw poll or survey. I mean, this is analogous to the budget itself or capital project, where it's a decision that has a direct fiscal impact on the residents. So why would this be the kind of thing that we would put on the ballot as letting the residents decide for themselves whether or not they would want to essentially provide this benefit to veterans and take on this burden to the non-veterans?
You know, I think that's something that could be discussed and we ought to discuss as we go through our planning around how you would do this process. My understanding of that is that there are some things that are within the power of the board. You know, as board members, you're vested with certain authority and you are required to make those decisions that are yours. There are some you may not make, and those decisions are reserved to the voters. Approval of borrowings, for example, or of a capital project. You offer it, but it is the public's, the voter's choice. They have to separately authorize that. As a board, you could not authorize a capital project without that vote. The converse of that are things that are within the authority of the board to offer or to decide. What items are included in a budget, for example, are generally within the boundaries of the of board decision making, not subject to public vote. There are other decisions that the board makes, 10-year determinations, so on, staffing, program decisions, all the things that are board decisions are yours to make. The legislature in this fairly clearly made this a board choice. This is your determination to be made. Where the question comes in is this idea of a straw poll. Is there an opportunity to put up for vote or a sort of a vote, I guess, the idea of what do you think about it as a public and pull this lever? If you do that, it doesn't relieve the board of the obligation to make the decision. But what it does is sort of offers the opportunity for confusion in the process. You know, are you binding yourself to what that straw poll is? If so, are you really giving up your authority? Can you do that? Could an aggrieved party that disagreed with the decision then use that to take you to task or to take legal action? It's a complicated question. I don't think we have to answer it tonight, but. I think I would advise that we think about that carefully before you move forward with that. It has some appeal. I understand the appeal of it because it does seem like a community question. You know, can't we wait? This is up to you. Because as I say, it's revenue neutral to us as a school district. So give us your best advice. But unfortunately, I think the law is not necessarily set up that way.
I think just in commenting on that, there are other ways also to find out what the public thinks. And we've got our conversations on education. We could do a electronic survey, and we could visit different community stakeholders and do some research that way, because I think what you're trying to get at is what does the community think about it before we make a decision on it.
Certainly, and we employ all of those tools in what we do. This is just such so much more direct on a direct impact. As Mark mentioned, it's not like we're talking about line items in the budget. It is talking about how we unevenly distribute the budget burden amongst the residents. So it is much more significant, I think, much more directly impactful on the residents.
Yeah.
On all sides of the issue, sir.
I don't disagree. I think what everything we send to the voters is absolute, where if they vote yes or no, it's absolute. And in this case, and I think you covered this a little bit, we may make a different decision, or a board in the future can make a different decision than what the voters might have thought they voted on. But also, I think the important part to remember is this is why we're elected, to make these tough decisions. And, you know, this is a tough decision, but that's why we're here. So I wouldn't want us to abdicate that for any particular reason and set a precedent in regard to that.
And I, you know, and certainly, you know, there's, you know, I've seen in just the short term that this has been a possibility. There's a variety of opinion on how this should be structured, on what's appropriate. Certainly, you know, we understand honoring the service of the people who have served our country, and this is one way to do that. There's a lot of conversation that really needs to happen around this, and I think that's the that's the heart of my message. I think is however this turns out, it should in terms of levels that are appropriate or how the exemptions offered. I think the more informed our public is, so that we reach an understanding that everyone can support, because we'll all be impacted by it. For good and ill.
Any additional questions or comments? All right, let's keep talking about it and
you know, we know we're not going to take any decisions before March 1st because there's not enough time there, but definitely this is going to stay on our agenda so that we can talk about it, make sure we're taking the right decision.
Yeah.
Thank you. This concludes superintendent's reports. We are now on page 3 of your agenda. Financial items, donations and book fair proceeds. Donations and book fair proceeds totaling $805 for items in the 2013-2014 budget have been granted to Indian Landing Elementary School for Arts in Education from their HSA. May I have a motion, please, that the Board of Education approve an amendment totaling $805 to the 2013-14 budget as shown above, the amount submitted both as revenue and expenditure items, and express its gratitude to the donors for their generous support of Penfield Schools.
Second.
Questions or comments? Thank you. All those in favor? 6 in favor, none opposed. Thank you. Policy review. So we've been busy, as you can tell, from everything we're bringing for you for a first reading. Catherine, I think you are
just do a quick update and quick explanation on policy number 5710. These first four are transportation policies. Transportation program. There is a new language in the bold print on how to direct the questions regarding transportation. On policy 5720, we took out the wording voluntary transfers as we no longer have a shuttle. And just skipping over to 5750, the words have been added, quote, and school functions in the first paragraph. And that's to match the wording in the DASA laws. And these three transportation department changes most closely coincide with current practice. And then on policy 5740, qualifications for bus drivers, that is a new policy altogether. And then policy 7617, rationale for declassification of students with disabilities. Due to the changes in graduation requirements for students with disabilities and the elimination of the IEP diploma, the language in the section on graduation / aging out required clarification. This section was revised to reference the skills and achievement commencement credential or career development and occupational studies commencement credential options. And then on the last one, 7632, appointment and training of committee on preschool special education members. This is the rationale. A previous amendment to Education Law 4402 no longer required the additional parent to attend the CSE meetings unless requested in writing 72 hours in advance. A new amendment to Education Law 4410 now establishes the same requirement for the additional parent at the CPSE meetings. Revised language has been added indicating that the additional parent member is no longer required to attend a meeting of the CPSE committee unless so requested in writing by the parent or person in parental relation or a member of the CPSE within 72 hours of the meeting. And that's it.
Thank you, Catherine. Board members, these are here for first read and will be available on our website for public comments, and they will come back to us for approval at future meetings. Do you have any immediate question right now or no? We're good. Okay, thank you. This concludes board's business. Under president's remarks, I just have a couple. First, we had the reminder about the vote on February 13th, and please, we ask this community to come out, exercise your right to vote. This is important. Any decision we take for the schools is important. So come out and exercise your right to vote, please. I also want to thank the community for the jazz fundraiser. A lot of us were there. The auditorium was full both nights. It was just unbelievable what the teachers did, what the students did under the leadership of Jim Dozier, And where do I even, I mean, not only Jim, but also Diana Brahamian, and also Shayna Stewart, and also, you know, all the teachers from the middle school and the elementary school, so many kids, and such an outstanding artist, that would not be possible without everyone's work, but also without the support of this community. So thank you. It was just outstanding two evenings there. You know, I hope that people enjoyed it. And other than this, we had the legislative breakfast last weekend, and that brings us then to under new business for legislative updates. John, do you want to talk about this for a little bit?
Very briefly, we had, and for our public, we had over 100 school board members and our legislative delegation at the breakfast Saturday morning to talk about important issues, as we all know they are, but this is part of our ongoing effort to bring awareness to our legislators in regard to the tough times that are encroaching upon our students', you know, best interests, really. I think, back to Mark's thought there, two givens that I did hear, one from the Assembly Majority Leader and the Assembly Minority Leader, the governor's education dollars will be increased approximately maybe 1 to 2%, but I really did hear a given that in this election year, no one will be late with their part of the budget, and it may be 11:59 p.m. On that point, but they will not be late, all the men in the room. So I think we can hopefully think that that'll happen again, that it'll be on time.
Any other additional questions or comments about legislative breakfast with members? All right, I just want to thank you for being there. We always have a great representation, Dr. Grimm, for being there with us, and, you know, and for MCSBA for organizing a great morning. I think it was really good, especially being able to break up and, talk to different legislators and being able to give them specific examples. That was really a great morning. Hopefully, something will come out of it. We'll see how that plays out. And I guess that's it. If there's no more business, please may I have a motion that the meeting be adjourned at 9:12 p.m. Second. Questions, comments? All those in favor? 6 in favor, none opposed. Thank you.